Hello! You know, we have so much going on in this studio. There's all these little boys and little girls in sunbonnets. They're running all around the room. They're bugging us, don't you think? Yeah, little sunbonnets. They're so cute. Do you have your sunbonnet?
I do.
Come on, get yours on. If I have to wear mine, I have to wear yours.
You know what? Something happened to my strap. It got cut off. Do you think that happened yesterday?
No, because it wasn't in the room. Actually, Ellie made the sunbonnet last night. This is for her gold rush days. And it's still got pins in it. Are you ready to see all these cute little boys and girls running around in sunbonnets? All right, you know the noise. Wait, you didn't see it yet.
They're practicing.
Ah, isn't that cute? That's so cute. That's made out of Forever Love fabric. And this is actually my sunbonnet pattern. And I call her Sue. And the little boy is Sam. And Sue sewed on the buttons. How's that? How is that? Is that cute? So David did all of the sewing on the blocks. Brenda set them together. And Mary Jo Rembo quilted it. Teamwork, huh?
They I got off good just doing the buttons. Three buttons.
So I thought I would like to tell you, not I thought, I am going to tell you a little bit of history about sunbonnet Sue. Do you want to know it?
Yeah.
You better, you want to know it. Okay, let me go back to my table. Is Eric going to run up here?
No, he'll be fine.
Oh my goodness, where is he? And we even lost the picture of who they're supposed to say, Sue. Do you have my picture over there? My opening number. Have my picture.
Which picture?
Well, ask the question.
The question is, who is the mother of sunbonnet Sue?
Bertha Corbett.
Bertha Corbett. And here is the picture of Bertha Corbett.
Oh, is that what's over at your office?
No.
Oh.
I didn't take it anywhere. Isn't she cute?
Yeah, she's very cute.
Well, anyhow,
Google her.
We love Bertha Corbett. And what's really interesting, that she also was the first one.
She's on the floor, Eleanor.
She's on the floor. That's her.
No, that's something else on the floor.
No, well, anyhow, we'll show you later. We'll go on. Bertha Corbett is really cool because she was the first one to draw this lady. You guys know her. Who is she? No, she's like the Dutch cleanser lady. Remember that? The Dutch cleanser lady? Do you know that this appeared in 1908 and Bertha Corbett drew it? It was just really fun. They had this little, it says, it means scrubbing efficiency. Old Dutch cleanser. I still use it. Do you guys use it? Well, this is the ad for it, and there are all these cute little cards that we had. I love this one because look at all the ladies scrubbing at the end of the brush. Isn't that funny? They're all dressed up.
That's pretty funny.
And there they are again. You're supposed to clean your cutlery with it and your kitchenwares. That's really cool. Well, Bertha Corbett also wrote a primer. It was called the Sunbonnet Sue Primer. I'm so sorry.
There she is.
She was upside down.
I did not lose her.
You ready? There's Bertha Corbett. Aren't you glad you met her?
Yeah.
Anyhow, this is the book that she wrote. It's called The Sunbonnet Baby's Primer. It was a reading book for little kids. And they don't quite look like the sunbonnets of today, huh? No aprons on them. The little sunbonnets are very, very cute. And about the very same time, there was a man that also designed a sunbonnet. And he actually had, in 1910, he had it in the Ladies Art Needlework. Pretty old, huh? And so what he did, he has all the bonnets, but he did little cards. They're little playing cards that he had. And he did them all in Monday, this is Monday, what she's doing, her wash, you guys know. Oh, and upside down Tuesday, she's cleaning. The man's name was Bernhard Hall. Bernhard Hall. I'm going to give you a quiz at the end, right? So you're going to have to remember. Anyhow, these are like the two first ones that I know of. So then along comes Grandma Dexter. Grandma Dexter, and she worked for Virginia Snow.
Would you like to see the Bonnet Baby quilt?
Oh, yes! I'm running on. Aww. So this was Mr. Hall's design, and we actually sent, the lines were all stamped on white muslin. We sent it to Teresa's mother. There's that one, and there's a second one.
Okay, we'll do the
Doris,
second
do you
one.
Want to help her? You're just sitting and enjoying yourself. There's another one because they're car-
I can do this one, but I'll definitely
help
on the next
gonna
one.
The quilts are going to get really big.
Oh, yeah, let's
big.
Get the two shortest people up here.
Yeah, the two shortest people. So then this is another one. All doing, they all have little different bonnets on them. They're all doing something of the week. Aren't they cute?
Cute.
They're really cute playing together. I really think they're great. So when you're done looking at that, and I'm okay. Still looking for where did Grandma Dexter go? Don't know. But her little girls are a little grown up. They're still in elementary school. They're called the Sunbonnet Girls, and they have different things to do. Now, Doris, this is a really big quilt. So
we
you
just
have
kind
to
of
help.
Flop it out.
I
okay.
did get the blocks. And I did sew it together so that
and we go as high as we can.
And we sent it out for hand quilting. Isn't it cute? It's just really fun. Big dolls. They're 18-inch square blocks. That you make a quilt really fast that way, huh? Well, let me see, because here is the original. I'm trying to find out what the price is. There they are along there with the Sunbonnet Garden. Okay, isn't that cute? Very, very cute. And it's nice and soft. It would be real cuddly. Really, really fun. All right, Virginia Snow. And Virginia Snow was sold to Lee Ward's. And after that, Lee Ward's was sold to Michaels. So it's interesting how the companies have evolved. I do know that this was probably the early 20s, don't you think? Early 20s, 30s, and it's just really fun. Okay, pass her on because she's going to grow up a little bit more. She's going to be this gorgeous lady. She's going to be the colonial lady. Let's see.
Okay.
The colonial lady. Here she is. And that's right from the catalog. And this one is really fun. I don't know what happened. This one's even missing some of her arms, or two of her arms. Do you see? Oh, yeah. Yeah, really cute. And I love that one. And this quilt maker was very creative. She added butterflies. She's got her umbrella and her butterflies. And look at the dresses. How cute they are. Look at the waist on those girls. Woo, ooh la la. Very, very fun. All right, so there's two sets, two pages of little girls, so sweet. All right, let's see
bigger.
The next one. Let me see. Ah, I think there's more, let's see.
Yeah, we have more of this.
Yes. Okay, now this one. This is really big and very, very heavy.
We need steps.
And really cute. They have their umbrellas and the tiny waist collars, big hat. So fun. Remember those long, skinny necks, because the next one you see, the quilt maker decided those necks were way too long and thin. That one I think I bought in Kentucky because it's very, very heavy.
Yes, it's very thick.
Very thick. And that's kind of what they're like in Kentucky. All right, pass them on. I think the next one is going to be David's grandmother's.
Yes.
Let's see. Yes. Okay. David brought this morning and shared. And I want you to notice, very pretty dress, thin, and look at the neckline. She added some hair. She did. She added, did all the stitching, and she beautifully coordinated. Yeah, what's so funny? Oh, yeah, you're missing the show.
I'll watch.
Okay, you turn around. Show Doris now. Okay, show Doris. Sue, did you bring the stuff that was on top of the last quilt that was over in the studio, over in the art department? I set some stuff on top of the quilt. Oh, you discarded it. Okay, that's okay. Okay, so do we have another colonial lady? Let's see. I forget. Lift it up. And I'll see. Anyhow, look how nicely they're folding it. David has been coming in the morning, but he grew up watching Quilt in a Day with his grandmother on television, and now he's collecting all of her quilts back.
I know this one. And then I'll go get
this one
she's
is
for.
From Sears and Roebuck, 1934. And it's a very different quilt. It's a different shape in the sunbonnet, don't you think? I can't figure out what the thing on the top is, if she needs to go to Victoria's Secret or what. If she just got old and dropped, what do you think? You think she did? She's out having a good time. She's got a little umbrella, but that shape is entirely different. And I really like the setting in it with the three different pastel colors, very 1934. And if you notice the border around the outside, they did a binding. So you guys can look now, but yeah. With a bias binding, they did diamonds and bias binding. I actually bought two identical ones, so that I can put them on my twin beds in Julian. Now is the time. Peek, you can look. Satin, that green, yes, 1934. I actually found that one identified. So it was really fun. Each one is so different. Okay, what I wanted to have is on the top, Sue. Actually, okay, thank you very much.
You're
I appreciate welcome. That. Whoops, we're gonna go back to the one that we looked at right here.
Thank you.
And it's really cute because they called her Daisy Bell. Isn't that cute? Mm-hmm. Daisy Bell. She has a little bit different gourd skirt. Some of them just have the curved bottoms. No shoes, no nothing on the feet. Actually, that's not the one yet, no.
Oh, we're not looking at this. Oh.
Don't look at that.
Oh.
It's not time. But anyhow, you can look at it yourself now. So I found this
go like
ad.
This.
Look at it.
Oh, we can look at
so
it.
So this was in a magazine, and I was just really intrigued. Order your favorites from this collection, and there is a little thing here about Daisy Bell. Apparently there was a contest, and if they renamed Daisy Bell, why would you want to do that? That would be really interesting. But anyhow, anyone sending in $1 pattern order will receive a pamphlet illustrating 36 other patterns. Send in a new name for Daisy Bell. I think that's kind of cute, don't you? Yeah. Daisy Bell is really, really fun. So for $1, too bad patterns don't cost like that these days, huh? All right, so now actually we want Ruby McKim's.
Okay.
We want Ruby McKim's.
This is Ruby McKim.
And so we are moving in through the 30s, and these are the Ruby Kim designs. And I looked through all my things, and I found a whole set of patterns Ruby McKim drew for Kansas City Star. Look for Little Bo Peep. Little Bo Peep. And this is the one that I found. Little Bo Peep has lost her sheep, help me, and can't tell where to find them. Leave them alone and they'll come home wagging their tails behind them. Didn't you do all these nursery rhymes with your children?
Yes.
Really fun. Little Bo Peep is the little girl. That's what you called her. And then Little Boy Blue. Little Boy Blue, come blow your horn. The sheep's in the meadow, the cow's in the corn. And where is the little boy who minds the sheep? He's under the haystack, fast asleep.
See, they knew it. They didn't know that this morning.
Yeah, that they didn't know that. I asked Teresa. I worked with Teresa on the little quilts. In fact, the one on the left, Teresa finished that one. I asked her if she knew the poems, and she didn't really recognize them. And then she remembered she said it in Spanish.
Oh.
In Mexico. She grew up in Mexico, and I just wondered how this would rhyme in Spanish. It's a funny thought, huh? Well, Teresa did the little Sue and, or no, I'm sorry, Little Bo Peep and Little Boy Blue. She blanket stitched the outside edges on the larger pieces, and on the smaller ones, she did invisible thread and a zigzag stitch. So it was really fun. David did the one on the left, and he actually used the blanket stitch. I think that's Sue's.
Teresa's.
Oh my God. Sue was gone for 2 weeks and or 2 months, and I can't even keep it straight now. 3 months. Was it that long?
No.
Okay. That was a long time.
I'm
she
still
came
smiling.
Back unstressed.
Mm-hmm.
And we decided we weren't going to get stressed today. But aren't they cute? So we're going to take a quick look at her in just a minute. But I pulled out my Kansas City Star, and there's the last three people that worked on the illustrations for the Kansas City Star. Here it's Ruby Short McKim. She was the original Star quilt artist, and she lived in Independence, Missouri. Remember, she was a businesswoman, and she was also the needlework editor for the Better Homes and Gardens magazine. That's pretty fun, huh? Well, that's Ruby, and the next one is Evelyn Folan.
This is our cue.
Evelyn Folan. She followed Ruby McKim, working at the Kansas City Star, and she did less. She was kind of Art Nouveau. She was an art teacher. She was a graphic designer. She did her distinctive signature. This is what you have to look at. Okay, we're switching back and forth. That's what you have to remember. Evelyn Folan, really funny. One day, she just didn't show up at the Kansas City Star. Nobody could figure out what happened, if she got married, if she got angry at the Kansas City Star, she just disappeared. But she left behind this little pattern called the Posy Girl. The Posy Girl, very different, huh? Her little, very, very cute. Actually, Sue found this on the internet just recently. Do you remember what we bought it for?
Like $45.
$45.
Yeah.
$45. It's hard for me to believe that somebody would actually part with it for $45 if it was for a little person or so. So I went to my favorite book, my Encyclopedia of Appliqué, because this, and it's by Barbara Brackman. She identified all the appliqué quilts, and she said, oh, nobody ever looks at that book. One day, I was on television showing this book. She walked past TV. She was in shock to see her book. But anyhow, right up here is the Sunbonnet Sue Ruby McKim design. So they do have the bonnets kind of similar to Mr. Hall's. And here she's got her family pets in there with her. One's a cat, one's a dog. It's really fun. And as you look, there's a whole page of different line drawings of Sunbonnet Sues. You think there's just one, huh? And even up here, there's more of them. It's really, really cute. Okay, we're moving along. Good. So, do we have the days of the week down there?
Mm-hmm.
Let me see. Okay, the days of the week. Ah, isn't that fun? It's my sunbonnet, Sue. We sent it to Teresa's mom again, and we did all the different days of the week. Okay, what do you do on Monday? And Tuesday? Wednesday? Now, they really held to this schedule, you know. And Thursday? Yippee! Friday? Yep. And Saturday? Baking. And, of course, on Sunday? Church. They went to church. And go back because you can see Teresa's little dog on a leash. She has had pugs. She had a little pug. Doesn't it look like a little pug?
Yeah.
With his little round tail. The church and then just quilting a day. Well, this is McCall's days of the week. They're very, very cute. I looked at the back on the label and it says 1930 something, but the last number was not available. But see, you could actually buy the little inked lines. You know how they're the little, they have the inks printed on them. And I'm really excited because somebody really used this. I know it was damp because it got all blurry. Aren't they cute? But such a treasure, the 1930s. All right. So we have and some more from the 1980s. Ta-da! What are we doing here?
Laundry.
Laundry. Sunbon Sue's doing laundry. And here she's
visiting.
Yay! And here she's cleaning. And look who it is. And this is how I really feel about cleaning. Isn't that funny? We took all these pictures. And I'm
baking.
Ah! That's just fun. Well, there is a lady called Jean Ray Lowry. Do you remember her? I'm not sure if she's still
I think she passed away.
She passed away. Anyhow, she did a series of books. Sunbonnet Sue Goes to the Quilt Show. Really fun. She's got her yardstick with her. She should have her gloves on. Sunbonnet Sue makes her first quilt. And this one was sent to me, given to me by my former assistant, Nancy. And she said, congratulations on all the great improvements at Quilt in a Day. This book was written for you. Sunbonnet Sue Gets It All Together at Home, Jean Ray Lowry. And let me see, let's go to the back. You can see, okay. So 10 minutes is enough for any quilter to tidy up before her mother-in-law's visit, right? And no matter how pressed for time, Sue makes an effort to have hot, delicious meals for her family. Yep. Okay, in this one, what does she say? Sue's sister-in-law writes a thank you note. It's an interesting little quilt, but I'd rather have it in taupe and avocado and king-sized by next month. And then she says, I should have given her an electric blanket. That would be good. Okay, and this one's just for me. Sue is dismayed. The Quilt in a Day kit she bought is in its fifth month. Too funny, huh? Mm-hmm. So there's all kinds of Sues out there, and we're just beginning to touch them, huh? So did any of you bring a Sue quilt? Oh, she did. You move forward. Oh, they're actually mine. Right? Are they antiques? They're antiques. Look, they're so much like mine. Can we bring them up here and just flip through them real quick?
I'll take your box for
you. Okay, take the box. Okay. This is very interesting. Look at these. How fun. Okay, so come over. Yeah, that's good. Wow, that's feed sacks. Definitely feed sacks. Blanket stitch. Look at her little hand. And look at the size of that foot. Oh, so she did something consistent. Did she do red bonnets? Nope.
No.
Nope. But nearly always, they're just two fabrics, one for the dress, and then maybe the three pieces, the hat, the hands, and the shoes. You really need to put this together.
Notice the uneven blanket stitch.
Yeah, picky.
No, I mean short on purpose, short.
Oh, I'm sorry. I'm sorry, Dorothy. Yeah. She said it is long and then it's short.
Yeah.
Long and short. I really like to hand stitch when I sit down at night. I like to, yeah, very, very cute. You've got a ton. Did you count them?
26.
26?
11 red. What
age? This is definitely feed sacks, and so is this. The texture in it is definitely feed sacks. You know, you actually can look up feed sacks and find out what year they were printed. So that would be really fun. But, okay, usually it's the green that just gives everything away. And I bet she did. She used red, and the red is magnificent. I don't see any green. But I think it was pretty popular in the 30s, in the 1930s. It was all of the people that introduced it. Thank you, Doris. Yeah, so where did you get them?
My daughter found them in the garbage.
She found them in a trash.
Her daughter found them in the trash.
It's sitting on top of a trash can next to her house.
They probably put it on the top because they thought somebody would come along and rescue it. Yeah. So we're going to start with Lily McKim. Yes, Pat. You bought one. Oh, no, you brought your bonnet.
Can I take it up?
Oh, my gosh.
That's so pretty.
That is beautiful.
I was born in 1927, and so I figure that's about 1930.
She was born in 1927, and she figured it's about 1930. Can't you? So you're like 3 years old. This is adorable.
I have a portrait. It's quite large of me in that bonnet.
Oh my gosh. Aww. She has the portrait of her in this bonnet. This is really wonderful. This is like the fabric is called
organza.
Organza. They use the same fabric for yo-yos. A lot of little yo-yos. They were just soft and they could gather around. That's priceless. And look at this little ornament right in the center. I'm really proud of you that you saved it all these years. That was really cool. Anybody else? You're good? You looked at Nan. Nan's not going to share anything. Okay, well, we are going to share how to do Ruby McKim's Bo Peep and Little Boy Blue. Do you have your books with you? Yep. That's good because I didn't bring mine. So you can go and just turn to where her patterns are. We don't have any on the table. Oh my gosh. Okay, so the instructions are very, very good. They're clear and easy to follow. Barbara Eckmeyer and Ruby's youngest granddaughter, Mary Lee, worked on the patterns. And they just kind of recreated them. But we did a couple of things that we thought we would make it really easy. And
This is a full set. That one we've gotten into.
Okay, that's good. Oh, good. So we put out a little extra purchase because I know what I don't want to do. And I thought you might not either. I'll show you. So you can take Ruby's patterns and trace them. But actually what we did was we printed all the patterns on paperback fusible. So you don't have to trace. Ooh, is that exciting?
Yeah.
It's very exciting. And if you look at the little sunbonnets, you see that the center row is the only one they're facing. Sue is on the left. Little Bo Peep is on the left and the boy is on the right. Well, then the top and bottom rows reverse. So you have one row when you need to make only one set, and then you have two pieces of printed paperback fusible for the top and bottom rows. Is that good? Oh, I know, that's very, very good. Pardon me?
Item number 7095.
7095.
And it retails for only $5.95.
Whoa. So what we recommend when you are tracing, if you group all of the pieces that are going to be the same color, and we already did that for you. So see, there's only usually two. This one, the bonnet is pink, and then the dress is a little lighter. And the little boy is not wearing a dress. He's wearing a shirt. That's called a shirt, and he has a hat, and he has pants. Good? And so all you do is get your pieces of fabric, and we actually used 5-inch charm squares, 5-inch charm squares. Isn't that cool? For these little guys, so if you get a whole package of charm squares, you could just make a whole bunch of these. It's really, really fun. So we did Sue this morning. I can't not call her Sue. Little Bo Peep, help me.
But you're looking at me.
I'm really tired. I needed a nap. Here's Little Bo Peep, but we have little boy blue to do. Of course, his hat is blue. So you just cut out the little section, you put this fusible side against the wrong side of the fabric, fuse it in place, follow your manufacturer's directions. And do you remember how long it's supposed to be?
You're gonna press from like 5 to 8 seconds.
5 to 8 seconds you press. And it's stuck down really good. It's on the wrong side. And actually, it goes really fast and easy if you gather the whole family around, right? Get the whole family, give them a pair of scissors. So the little shirt is going to be adorable in this plaid. I love it. And Sue's got some plain blue. Okay, the shirt and the sleeve go together. And do you see these little dash lines right here? That little dash line indicates that you tuck it under the other part. You tuck it underneath so you don't see that end. All right. Okay, so I recommend that you get your placement sheet ready. Let us see. We have, here's the little boy blue. Let's see, his shirt goes this way, so he's going to be this one. Yeah? They're mirror image. Okay? Remember, they're mirror image. And so you have to make sure that you have them going both ways. This is a placement sheet. The background is 7 inches square. Okay, we're going to put it on that. You can really see that. Light tables are really useful, but you can really see it pretty good. Okay, Sue, you ready?
Not yet.
I'm going to take.
I got all the little pieces.
Wasn't I clever? Okay, here's still an arm and a horn. Oh, yes, our skin color. We have all these colors of skin. We should call ask Michelle to bring us in all the skin colors, because I think that's really cool. The horn and the arm are two little pieces there. And you can just take the edges and go like this. Oh, Michelle! See if she hears. Yeah. Michelle! Okay, and peel it away. Some people take a...
Yeah.
Huh? There's a whole little basket. Okay, now, since you know this is the shirt, I would lay it on top right away. Okay, right in the spot.
I'm still cutting.
Yes, and this is the sleeve, and you can see that this little top part.
Hey, that's cool.
Yes, is this cool? This little top part. Oh, look at Doris, her mouth is wide open. But I am so excited about this, because we have so many different nationalities in this country, so many different colors of skin, that I think it's a great assortment. And you can just pick up one little piece, or look at this. Is that cool? The whole assortment. Candace, did you want one? This is the one you want? Okay, here, hold up. Whoa, I'm not very good with my hand. But anyhow, I really think it's great, especially if so many of us have grandchildren of different nationalities. And why not? We should try to make them realistic looking, huh? Okay, so how are you doing? So now we better put this down. Ryan, you want to get it and move it off the table?
Sure.
Thanks. Thank you, Joe. Joanne. Okay, and would you move your iron so Eric can see? I'm not too picky, am I? Okay, so she's got the hat on, and the little sleeve is going to slip underneath the hat. Pardon me? Yeah. Okay,
how's that?
Isn't that cute?
Is that good?
And slip that one. That's his hand. That's his sleeve. And what piece?
He's working on his pants.
You're working on his pants. So actually, they're little pieces, but just think you don't have to trace them. They're already pre-printed for you. It really helps if you use your stiletto to manipulate them around or just a little tweezer. There's actually two shoes and like two little pieces.
I don't know what happened to the legs.
The legs?
He doesn't have legs.
Oh, I have the legs. I have one leg.
That's a start.
That's a start. Okay, and it says right on it. It says legs. That's pretty cool. So it doesn't really take long, even if you just get some help. I think that the kids would really, especially with Sue helping, huh? But get it right in place on that placement sheet, or else you might not get it in the right place. Okay, here you go, and it's turned in the right direction. It's going to go right there. He's going to be a one-legged little boy, huh?
Yeah, he's got one leg.
That's okay. That's good. Well, when
one leg but two shoes.
He could be on the floor.
That's okay, right?
Yeah.
It's
just put it right in the middle. See, that would make really everybody happy.
Use your imagination.
Yes, really cute. Okay, so once you get it all down on there,
we're going to fake it.
Yes, he's very, very cute. Very, very cute.
Slide it out.
Yes, slide it out.
And now you can take your steam iron.
This is very important, this part.
This is.
Because you can't like slide it. It has to go straight down.
And you could give it
Or your little pieces will move.
Yes, they will.
Ask me how I know that.
Yeah. And I like steam right now. Yeah, there goes the steam. Okay, so once you press it on the front side, then just flip it over and you can press it on the back side. All right, it's ready for stitching.
Woo. All right.
That was fast, huh? Isn't that cute?
It is cute.
It's very, very cute. I love them. Okay, so I have been showing you the blanket stitch, haven't I? Mm-hmm. And so what I'm just going to do is show you a finished one. Okay, so you can get me. This is what David did, and he went crazy. He did a really good job. So this is the little boy in his shirt, and he used a blanket stitch and went the whole way around everything, the hands. He even made 2 feet. See 2 feet? And two pairs, huh?
Two legs.
Two legs, 2 feet, 2 shoes. See, Sue, that's how you're supposed to do it.
I don't know what happened.
That's the little boy, and look at the little girl. Isn't she cute? So on your pattern from Barbara and Mary Lee, you have this little bow. And this is just a little stitch that you can go ahead and do that and put it on there. It's just really, really fun to do. And then the little staff that Bo Peep has, this is a satin stitch so that you can get that right on there. Cute. All right, so I want to show you up close. We'll put these all out. Will you pull Sue, Teresa's over? Here we go. Sue, Teresa, what's your name again?
My name is Relaxed Person.
Relaxed Person. Don't get bummed out because I can't even remember your name. That's what you get for being gone so long. Okay,
Small price to pay.
Teresa's, she did just a blanket stitch around the dress, the sleeve, the hat. And she actually did the blue down here and the shoes. She decided the hand, she would just do invisible thread and a zigzag stitch. And she did the little horn around there. Very, very cute. And then little Bo Peep, she did, we call this a stem stitch?
Mm-hmm.
A little stem stitch. Very, very cute. And she used a little decorative stitch on her sewing machine on the hat. That's very cute, huh? Mm-hmm. Very, very cute. Lots of fun. Ah, so you're actually setting them together.
I
sewed this one together. And of course, the little sunbonnets were all done and probably took me an hour and a half to sew the top together. So it goes really pretty quick. So you start out with a lattice strip in between the two rows, or the three rows. Get those done, press the seams toward the lattice, and then shorter strips go in the top, middle, and bottom. You're doing so good.
Oh, thank you.
Yeah, that's what she said when she came back. She didn't touch the sewing machine the whole trip, but she said today she did remember how to sew. Okay, and then once you get that whole middle together, you add long strips onto each side. Is this fast? So I was concerned because there weren't cornerstones to help me line up everything, but I just did little tick marks to help keep that middle straight. You can really see it if it's off just a little bit. So I literally drew little lines. That's the teal is the first border, and then this is the second border that goes around the outside edge. The charm pack is very contemporary looking. It looks entirely different than the one done with the 30s reproduction. Don't you think? But I just think it's really cute. It's very, very charming. Charming! Yay! So we have two more that we get to sew.
Yep.
We have a whole little quilt.
We gotta get that leg in there though.
We're gonna get one for every granddaughter. Actually, I got into my stuff. And I found I think I have enough sewn pieces for every little girl and every little boy in my family. Only one little boy. All right. I was really excited, though, because I love to have something like this to keep me awake. Oh, of course, I forgot my things in my backpack. I was going to bring that. So I'm going to show you. This is Sam. And what I do, what I've done in my book.
That's right. We borrowed someone's book.
We forgot my book. My Sunbonnet Sue book was done in 1999, I think. 1999. And I remember trying to think, I'm going, oh my gosh, applique for somebody. And I remember walking through a fabric store and I said, oh, I could use lightweight, non-woven, fusible interfacing and turn under the raw edges. What an idea! So I taught a class and we actually drew all the pieces. Were any of you in that class? We drew all the lines for Sunbonnet. We just used the pattern in the book, so you can do it with plain. It's right here. You just put the plain fusible on top, trace on the lines. And then we go, oh, let's print them! So I had Mary Pat Henderson in my class, and she said, oh, I'll find you a printer. And so she looked all over, and she did find a printer. And what's really funny, it was Merritt's good friend over in Oceanside. So that's when we started printing all the patterns for Sam and Sue. Now I can say Sam and Sue, because this is what I called mine. All right? Well, the little hands are so tiny on there. I go, oh, what are we going to do? How are we going to do this? So had this ingenious idea. There's a little dash line right here on the hand. So if you just take your scissors, let's see, and let's just cut that out. Make sure you leave a seam allowance. Okay, let me see. I think I'm doing good. Cut out this little section out of the fabric, and then take a strip, and all we're going to do is sew this on right here. This is going to become the hand. Is this smart or what? I think so. Okay, so it's just a quarter of an inch. I do have my open toe foot on. I'm going to be using that to sew around the outside edge. So let's see. Quarter inch seam. Just stitch right across there. Woo! Okay, and then you just cut. Let me get my machine set up. Okay, so you just take and you do a little clip along the side and flip the seam underneath so you don't see it because this is nice and light. And then when you fold this back up, you've just got that hand lined up with the dash line. Ah, ooh, cool. And you can do the same thing down here with a little shirt piece. And then make some suspenders too. Remember we saw that? So when you sew on this fusible interfacing, the fabric is right side up underneath, bumpy side against the right side of the fabric. Set your stitch length at 1.8 because this fusible will tear. I like to lighten the pressure on my presser foot. Right now it's at 3. I'm going to reduce it down to 1. That's so you can just drive all around this really quick. All right. Okay, I think I've got it. So all you do is just sew on the line. You just sew completely on the line. Use your needle down feature and so that you can pivot. When you lighten the pressure, you can just easily go around. Okay, needle down, pivot. I feel like we talked about this. Did we talk about pivoting on the outside edge? Didn't we do the blanket stitch the last time? No? Oh my goodness, we didn't? Okay, see how if you just keep your fingers on it like this, and you can just kind of swing it around. Okay, I'm at a point. So you just pivot. So you sew on all of these lines. You sew completely around. From where you begin, you go over top of it and completely, you can even lock stitch it. Okay, so we're moving along here pretty good. So do two of these. I always work in two so that I can go ahead and mix up my pieces. And so I'm going to show you. This one is all stitched down. I put two little shoes on there and the hand. So then you just go ahead and you take this and you trim 1/8 inch away. Use really sharp scissors. And let me just see. This is great TV work. Now that I found all of these pieces in my garage, I'm really excited. I've been shopping in my garage. I have not emptied out one single box yet. I'm trying. So let's just go ahead. We'll take the dress. I can turn the sleeve. Do you want to? I'll turn the sleeve and Sue will cut the dress, okay? So
you get something big to cut.
Yeah. Yay. So on the interfacing, you want to separate it. Oh, you have scissors. That's cool. I want to separate it. Okay, so you want to make a little slit in here. But you don't want to cut the fabric. That's smart, right? Okay, so I did a little cut, a little slit, only about an inch. Okay, then you need to have this fat-free straw. Habit is the best place. Best burgers and best straws. And You need to have a ballpoint bodkin for turning. How many of you already have a ballpoint bodkin? Let me see. So you guys have seen me do this? Have you seen me do it?
Yes. Yeah.
Ah, fine. Well, I'll do it real quick. Okay, so you stick out. You push your straw to one end, turn the fabric so that it's on the end, and you just push the ballpoint on the bodkin into the straw, halfway, remove it. It's halfway turned. So now you go back to the second half, put it right in there, and just push it in. And then you can go ahead and let's see. I only have one bodkin. So the bodkin has this curved edge on it, and it's really nice for just running around the outside. And you can see how it just smooths it out. You get really good when you make a whole quilt of sunbonnets. There, actually, looks pretty good that way, huh? And you want to do the dress? Okay, and so now you know that the only time you want to press is when it's on the pressing mat, but you can go ahead the applique pressing sheet. So you can just use a wooden iron. I have a fancy dancy one. We just found it in my drawer. It's autographed. I love it, you know, because a lot of husbands make them for their wives, and I know one wife said, okay, honey, will you go make me a wooden iron? And he ran down to the basement, and he ran in with his wooden iron, and he handed it to her and said, here, honey, I don't know how you're going to plug it in.
It was big, too.
It was big. Yeah. Okay, so let me see what I have here. So I like to stuff some of the pieces. So how about want to stuff a dress? A skirt. Okay, here is your background, and you can find a placement sheet. So I like to use lightweight cotton, 100% cotton, so it doesn't melt. So just place it on the cotton. This is your pattern. You don't have to have another pattern. Just cut around the outside edges. You can figure out how much you want to add dimension. If you want to do just your hat or your dress, doesn't matter what you do, and you really don't even have to stuff pieces at all. Be careful that you don't cut your interfacing. I just slid a little bit. Oh my gosh.
Placement sheet.
Placement sheet. Okay. Hemostats. Do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do. Okay, so you can just take this, take your skirt, grab hold of it in one end, just open it up and stick it right in there. And don't look too close, so that little... Actually, it's just a little sliver right on the side that I think whenever I put my blanket stitch on, it's just going to cover it. Aren't I lucky? Okay, so when you turn it over from the wrong side, you can actually see where your cotton batting is through the interfacing. So just pull it, grab hold of it with the hemostats, pull it out to the corner. This one went right over. You can just manipulate it around in there. Make it nice and flat out to the edges. Good, huh? Okay, so now let's see. I have green, and I also have, pink hands, pink shoes, and let's see. You can put that together. See, look how cute. See, in the time that we were just here, that she actually cut all the pieces. Oops, but I didn't. Oh, here it is, the bonnet. So it doesn't take you long at all.
Is she running or just standing?
Is she running? We have one that you could put it right in the middle.
This is
she
the
could
standing.
Stand. Or if you want her to run.
There you go.
She could be running
two.
Like crazy, yes.
Action
I found
shot.
Out. Yeah, that's cool. And I was looking through this one, and I found that I had started doing an even blanket stitch, but I made it really big. There's just two strands of floss, two strands, so it's nice and big. Yeah, and you can just get a little flower. You can mix up the colors. And actually, when I did the book, I did quilt the center, and then I just did a quilt as you go where I added the lattice the whole way around the outside edge, because I knew that I couldn't quilt this. And you can stitch all around there. When we did the new one, we didn't bother with the batting. We just did it like we were going to sew the one unit together and sent it to the long arm quilter. Weren't we clever?
Okay. So I pressed it on the top, but then I have to press it from the back side too.
Yep.
Because of all the batting in there, it's pretty thick.
Yeah.
I didn't want to miss that point.
That's good. You did good. So it's just really fun to do. You have any questions about it?
Look how cute.
Yeah.
The bonnet and the dress that you put the batting in.
Yes. I would. Yeah. I wouldn't do that. The little arms are a little tricky, but. No, you don't have to.
The feet and the arm, typically not.
Yeah. Yeah. And this one I just stacked all up and fused it on top of there. So we were putting this around, I think, around a room or something like that. It was just decoration. It was really fun. We had a good time with it. Okay, you got any questions? Well, Sue has more ways that you can put sunbonnet together.
Oh, fun ways.
Fun ways. Why don't, okay, do you think we should move that iron while
yeah,
you do this?
We're done with it, right?
Yeah, we're done with it.
Okay, I'm gonna get rid of it.
Okay, you get rid of it.
It'll be in the way. So, I don't know how many more years ago it was, but we used to do a lot of entertainment for our Christmas parties when you were employees. And at first we were really energetic, and we'd do little skits, and some people would play musical instruments and have fun. Well, then people started losing interest, you know, as the years went by. So Eleanor sweetened the pot and said, okay, I'm going to give the winner $100. So now all the employees want to do this again. Well, I don't like Sunbonnet Sue at all. And I think it's probably because my name's Sue, and they always go, oh, Sunbonnet Sue, and I'm going, ugh. So anyway, I decided to do a little skit with all the little Sunbonnet Sue characters with my son Dylan. He was kind of little at the time, and he's pretty creative about things he can do. So this is the story. It's called The Demise of Sunbonnet Sue, and it's about when Sunbonnet Sue travels all around the United States. Okay, so it starts off in the fall, and Sunbonnet, her mom told her, go out to the school bus, you're supposed to go catch it, okay? And she goes, oh, okay, so she goes, she takes one look at the school bus, and she starts running. So this is the beginning of her trip. See how fast she's going? It's all motion and placement of feet. Okay, so there you go. Well, she decided that she was going to go up and see Mount St. Helens. And I don't know if you guys remember, but when Mount St. Helens was going off, there'd be people, hikers, that would go up and look over the edge. And us who were watching it on the news were thinking, what idiots these are. They're looking over the edge. So anyway, so Sunbonnet decided, well, I'm going to go look over the edge. And so she did it, and it erupted. And so when it erupted, she went flying in the air, right, because all the hot fumes. Well, she didn't actually land until she was up in Alaska. And when she got to Alaska, all the salmon fishing were spawning, so they're all going upstream, and all the eagles know that this happens, so all the eagles were flying around looking for them. Well, she was watching the salmon, but the eagle watched her and picked her up, thinking she was a salmon. And then he decided, okay, well, she's not gonna taste very good, right? So he lets her go, and she gets stuck in the current, you know, the air current way up there, and does not land until she's in Wyoming. And when she's in Wyoming, she lands in a Indian and cowboy reenactment. So they started chasing her. Here are these Indians just chasing her along. You know, now she's going really fast now, right? So anyway, it's pretty amazing what you can do with a little faceless form. I do like that part of her. So anyway, So she decides, okay, I'm getting out of the wild, wild west. This is crazy out here. So she decides she wants to go to Chicago. And so she's going to Chicago, and she's walking down Michigan Avenue, and she's enjoying, you know, the Wrigley House, and, you know, all the things to see, all the nice buildings and restaurants and museums and all these kind of things. Well, it got kind of dark, and as it got dark, she kind of lost her way, and she went into a part of Chicago that's not too good. So she had a little problem or a little run-in, and she got mugged. But I just be assured it's only a surface wound. Okay. Yeah. So she's okay.
Only a flesh wound.
Only a flesh wound. Okay, so she goes down. She's going to go into the South because she hears people are really nice in the South, and she really wanted to go have some frog legs. So she goes to New Orleans, and she goes in the restaurant, and she orders frog legs. Well, they bring the plate of frog legs out with a big high dome. You know those, I've never been to a restaurant like that, but they go and they open it up, you know. Well, anyway, they open up, and the frog was sitting there and ate her. And this is the little remnants of her. See how happy this frog is? Yes, this is one in one Dylan's coloring books. So, but I
really cute frog.
It's really a cute frog. Yeah.
Yeah,
it's
and
cute.
I like
well,
that.
The frog ended up didn't really want her, so she starts heading east. She's on her way to go to Florida, and she has to go through Georgia. And in Georgia, if you get south of Atlanta, there's a ton of snakes out there. So she didn't quite escape, and here she is. Going along. That's a pretty good one, huh?
Yeah.
If you've ever seen a snake eat something. Yeah. So here she is. Well, snake didn't really want her either. Now she's going through the Everglades, which is really kind of funny because I was actually in the Everglades on Saturday searching for alligators. But fortunately, I did not find any. But anyway, here's the alligator chasing some Bonnet Sue through the Everglades. I know the teeth.
She's not running fast.
No. Yeah, he just looks like he's like teasing her, you know. The alligators really don't want anything to do with you. They just want to scare you and send you on your way.
They don't want
to
eat.
That's what they told
me. They really don't
want
to eat you?
No. No. We don't have enough meat on us. So she goes all the way out to the coastline, and she sees one of these big boats with all these men on it, you know, one of those cattle boat, fishing boat things. She goes, oh, I want to go there. So she goes, sneaks on the boat, and they look down. They thought she was a new kind of bait. So that's what she did. They put her on the thing. And she was like shark bait. And I had to take this one out for a while because there's all those shark attacks out in Florida. So,
yeah,
I had to take that out. But it's back now because they've got that under control. So she starts heading north, and she's getting kind of hungry. And she starts smelling really good things going on. Her stomach's starting to growl. And then she's like, oh, what's all that banjo music? And really, what's still going? So she goes up there, and it was in Tennessee, and they're having a barbecue. And they thought they were supposed to barbecue her. So here she is on the spit going around.
That one's funny.
I know. We did a show in Tennessee, so I had to add a Tennessee one in. And I love the barbecue in Tennessee. So anyway, so finally she goes, okay, well, I really have to get a legitimate job. I mean, I need some money. I'm hungry. So she goes up to Schenectady, New York. Well, it's actually the research and development for General Electric. She goes up to the personnel office and she goes, I really need a job. Is there anything I can do? I'm just a little girl. And they say, well, do you know how to make toast? And she goes, I can make toast. So here she is testing the toasters. This isn't what they quite had in mind. But she did pretty good. But then she got tired of that. It was kind of a hot job. So she got out of that and she decided she was going to go serve her country. And she wanted to join the armed forces. And she loved the army the best. So she joined the army. Here she is in the army. See, she can march. See, just by putting fatigues on her, you can do a whole bunch of things. Yeah, so here she is. And while she was in the army, she met some other people who wanted to quilt and learn, just like she wanted to learn how to quilt. So they would get together when they had some time off. And finally, they got their leave all at the same time. And they decided to go to Paducah, Kentucky to the big show. So they go to the big show, and they're all excited. They're looking at the award-winning quilts. But unfortunately, no one said, don't touch the quilts. So here's her friends, and her got taken to jail. See?
Busted.
Nice in stripes, isn't it? So anyway, she didn't get to go back to the Army because she had to get discharged because she got arrested. But she did go down to New Mexico, and she really wanted to get her faith in order before, you know, she passed on, and she wanted to serve her community. So here she is at a convent in New Mexico. Quite peaceful at the convent, New Mexico. And it's a good thing she did, because she ended up in heaven.
Aww.
So that's the last one. That's the story of Sunbonnet.
That's a cute one.
Yes.
The demise of Sunbonnet.
So several years ago, Eleanor and I were teaching in Berlin, Ohio, which is an Amish community, big Amish community. And we had days of classes. I think you did like two lectures and things like that. And the people were so kind to us. They showed us all around, and it was really fun. And the last day, they had this big luncheon for us, and they kind of put us up on the stage with their organizer. It was like a wedding table. It's really kind of odd, but we were just sitting there going, hi. And they wanted to present us with two things. So for Eleanor, they presented her with, because she knows she loves, she's so patriotic that she loves red, white, and blue. So they had made her that eagle off the front of Star Spangled Favorites, and it was all hand quilted. It's beautifully done. Mm-hmm. And then they thought, since my name was Sue, they should give me this quilt. But it is really cute. But I thought that she was going to wet her pants because she knows how I feel about Sue. So it's really kind of fun because, you know, in the Amish community, you know how we kind of have lots of Smiths and Joneses and things like that. Well, there are Yoders and Millers. And so it actually has a really nice label. And it is Piece by Rosie Miller and Quilted by Maddie Yoder. So I just think that's so cool.
That's really cute they signed that.
Yeah, isn't that fun? So I really like that. My husband thought it was really funny when I brought it home, too. Like, what? They gave you that?
So what size are those?
These little ones? I think they like started at 6. I think they're 5.5.
They're 5.5.
So yeah, they're just a little bit.
Look what
little.
We have. Doo doo.
Yeah, little ones.
Isn't that cute? So we thought that Sue and Sam would be really cute miniaturized. And what is really fun is that I actually got out my embroidery machine. David digitized the stitching, and I did it. After about 10 years, I wasn't afraid of my embroidery machine. Yay! And so how many of you have an embroidery machine? And you're going to go home and do it, right? So actually, David digitized this for you, and you can download it right from Quilt in a Day's website. Do you know the words that they have to do, Orion?
No, it's actually a long link, but customer service will send it to them.
Customer service.
Yeah, it's for people that are enrolled in Block Party.
Okay. Yeah.
It's only for you guys. It's like a special thing for you.
Yeah. Great. But isn't it cute? So if you've never done an embroidery machine, we did a little digital video just to show you. Are you ready? Okay, Eric, let's see. So you all know about a hoop, we think. You have to put your fabric in a hoop, and that just made the placement for the foot. Now we've got charm squares, and you just need two contrasting charm squares for each little block. That's all you need. And I did use black thread. So that I have to put the piece of fabric over that foot. And now it shows the foot a second time. It shows you first where to place your fabric. The second time you put the fabric on top and stitch on top of it. Now you need a little sharp pair of scissors, preferably a pair of applique scissors that have like a flat edge. And it's important that you get very, very close to that stitch without cutting it, because when it sews again, it'll just go in that stitch. Okay, rip for the dress. That's the placement, pretty fast. And you just go ahead and slip your fabric on top, and you just push the button again, and it stitches on top of the fabric, right on top of the stitching that's underneath. Pretty fast, huh? It's really fun to do. And then all you have to do is get your scissors. Well, the video got weird. Wonder what happened. Okay, So you stitch really close to the stitching. We found out that David was better at this step than I was, but I still enjoyed it. I was really excited. Okay, the dress is all stitched away. Now it's gonna do the bonnet. Push the button. Okay, there, whoop. Down and under. Is that amazing? And now I'm gonna take the purple charm square, what I have left of it, just cover those placement stitches, push the button, it stitches on the line. I think I never liked doing embroidery because it didn't have like the fabric, you know, it would just look like something on a t-shirt or something. But I love this kind of embroidery whenever you can actually have your fabric in place with it. Okay, and then stitch it away. So the next thing is the hand. And we have to get that purple trimmed away so we can get that little sleeve. Okay, there it is. Okay, now the sleeve is fabric, but the hand is actually stitched thread because it's so little. If you can, you can't see it on here, but anyhow. Okay, there's the sleeve, whoop, like that. The remainder of the purple goes on top. Not much left, not good for too much of anything now, huh? You'd stitch around the sleeve and trim it. I don't know why it's jumping like that. It's kind of weird, huh? Okay, so trim away. And the one thing, you don't get bored. You can do something else. You can read a book if you want to while you're waiting. So now I'm putting on a kind of a peach colored thread. This will become the hand. So you just pull it down through and just touch the button and the machine knows exactly where to go. You always have to have it in your hoop because that's what, you know, gives the guidance. It's how it all sets it up. Okay, and so you see a little bit of a thread. I think I eventually got that thread tucked in underneath the hand. There, you can see that. Good. So now the next thing is the blanket stitch. So I stitched with black thread just to look like the old quilts that were made with black blanket stitch. Were some of our quilts done with black, the black blanket stitch? Yeah, because Doris's were too. Okay, so this is the machine that's busy stitching right around. It's getting on the outside of the line, biting in. And there's a little secret. If you mess up just a little bit, you get a very fine point Sharpie, black Sharpie. And you can just color in the little spots that you missed. And then you can see how it's jumping, going around to the hand, and now all we've got left is the hat. So you can do a little bit of decoration right on top, and just go back, trim all of your threads, and there is a little flower on there too. We put a little flower on the top. Trim up everything on the back, and that's it. Wow! And everything's perfect, huh? So are you going to go out and get an embroidery machine? No. No? Come on, Sandra. No, you don't want to do that. Whoa, be careful, Orion.
We still have a couple of quilts down here.
We have some more. I have the world's smallest sunbonnets. Oh. Is that crazy? They're like a picture. They're
like a fabric.
Somehow, some like maybe iron on. They're just pressed on there. They're a little stiff. This is really cute, huh? That's really cute. Now that's the easy way. Just take a picture of one. Okay, and this one is just very traditional. Not anything real fancy, just with the lattice set around it, but very, very doable to do.
It's, I think it's the cover quilt.
Oh, it could be the cover quilt.
I think it
quilt.
Is, too.
So this was this was one of Judy Rothermel's. Yeah, it is the cover quilt. Judy Rothermel
pretty
was
fancy.
Designing 30s fabric for Marcus Brothers. If you remember, it started out as the Aunt Gracie's fabric. And it really made Marcus Brothers. One of the salespeople called me up and said, thank you for putting out Sunbonnet Sue in these Marcus Brothers fabrics. And this is actually an antique block, all antique blocks, a little bit larger. And I just set them together the exact same way as I did with my other blocks.
And they're hand quilted.
And they're hand quilted. That is really cool. Oh, you know what? I think I remember who did it.
Is it Jane?
No, it was one of my friends, I remember, hand quilted it. So much fun. So,
there you go.
May you have a sunny day too. It's too much fun. You're very welcome.